Glenda presents this unabridged recording of The Shadow Thief, written and read by Alexandra Adornetto. This book is dedicated to my grandfather and everyone else out there who refuses to grow up. This book begins with a quote from Peter Pan and Wendy by J.M. Barrie. Then Wendy saw the shadow on the floor, looking so draggled, and she was frightfully sorry for Peter. "How awful," she said, but she could not help smiling when she saw that he had been trying to stick it on with soap. Part 1. The Adventure Begins. Chapter 1. A Town Called Drabville. When you open a book and take a first hesitant glance at the page before you, the crucial factor that determines whether to continue reading or discard the book in disappointment is the opening sentence. After pondering long and hard over the opening sentence of this particular book, I have come to the conclusion that you must write it yourself. Sadly, if you are a person who is a little short on imagination, you might come up with such opening sentences as "once upon a time," "long, long ago," or "far, far away in a magical land." Boring. You are going to have to do better than that in order to do justice to the incredible story about to unfold. Perhaps it may help you to actually read a little of this story before making a decision, as we all know that opening sentences written in haste are never a wise idea. As far as beginnings go, one of my all-time favourites has to be "All children, except one, grow up." An opening like that cannot help but capture your attention. So, whilst you gather your thoughts on opening sentences, I should probably stop burbling and begin to tell the story, which is the reason you opened this book in the first place. As it happens, this story involves a girl. A young and rather pretty girl, with the unfortunate, although admittedly highly original name, of Milli Klompet. Of course, on the odd occasion when Milli spoke to a person long enough for them to ask her name, she made sure to leave out the last three letters, and was always quick to say that she was not given a surname due to strong religious reasons. So, due to strong religious reasons, throughout this book, I shall refer to her simply as Milli. This book also involves a town. A town called Drabville, which was the place where Milli was born and lived with her family. Drabville was an orderly town, presided over by a Mr. and Mrs. Mayor, who were both popular and much admired. They made regular public appearances to report town news, snip ribbons at the unveiling of new buildings, launch new initiatives, and give out Citizen of the Week awards. The people of Drabville were very proud of the mayors and their exemplary town. Problems such as poverty, crime, and unemployment had been eradicated by the implementation of a series of restrictions known as the Code of Conduct. This code comprised a set of rules that everyone was happy to abide by, even if it meant the loss of small freedoms. For example, citizens were prevented from wearing colours other than black, beige, or mushroom in the streets. Children were not allowed out to play after 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and venturing out of doors without the Drabville crest displayed somewhere on your person could incur a hefty fine. There were severe chastisements for breaking any of the rules, but breaches rarely occurred, for few citizens of Drabville had any desire to break the rules. Milli found the sameness of her town insufferable, but inescapable. Every house was designed by the same architect. Or I should say, the architect designed one house and every other was replicated in its image. They were even painted the same colours. Grey with shiny black doors and brass door knockers. The identical rectangular lawns sat side by side. Not one branch of the knotted black trees lining the streets was out of place, and the square slabs of concrete making up the footpath were not blemished with even the smallest of stains. A greyness pervaded Drabville, so thick that it not only obscured sunlight, but drained the colour out of everything. Because of it, butterflies were rarely seen, owls were wide awake at midday, and silhouettes, had they been detectable, would probably have been mistaken for ogres. The town was dead, Milly thought. You could search its every nook and cranny and not find a single speck of individuality or colour. For some time, Milly had sensed something missing in the townsfolk too. But as she was unable to explain it to herself, there seemed little point in raising it with anyone else. She couldn't say exactly what it was that had left them, but she knew it was something important, something invaluable. Milly did not know at the time this story begins that it would be up to her to restore it to them. Milly led a rather solitary life. Her mother had died when she was just 4 years old, so, regrettably, they never got the chance to know each other well. Although her memories of her mother were blurred, there were three things Milly did remember quite distinctly. The first was her mother's name, Enid Rosemary Klompet, which worked like a mantra for dispelling the bout of insomnia that inevitably followed a nightmare. The second was the coolness of her mother's hands, the touch of which had never failed to soothe her out of a tantrum. The third was simply her mother's pet name for her, which no one used anymore. Little Millipede. Nobody would speak to Milly about her mother's death, or the exact circumstances surrounding it. Instead, they muttered uncomfortably behind their teacups about unfortunate accidents and hurriedly changed the subject. Over time, Milly had learned not to bring the matter up with neighbours or townsfolk, but it did not stop her wishing they might occasionally make reference to her mother in conversation, or at least inquire whether Milly missed her. But they never did. They were all far too busy discussing how the indistinguishable flowers in their gardens were thriving, or what decoration to choose for the crust of the pie they were next going to bake. You are probably wondering why Milly didn't ask her own family to tell her about her mother. But you see, Milly Pop Klompet belonged to the most unordinary of families. Her older sister Dorcas had not ventured outside her bedroom for 2.5 years for fear of being eaten by one electrical appliance or another, and was convinced beyond reason that the family dog, Stench, was a spy working for an undercover government organisation. Then there was Milly's father, the only other person in the house to confide in. Milly might well have tried confiding in him, had he been able to concentrate long enough on what she had to say. Mr. Klompet had always been a dreamer, but since the loss of his wife, he lived in a permanent state of distraction. He was the sort of person who could sit staring at a jar of honeylick seeds for hours on end and thought the height of entertainment was making smiley faces out of the remains of his breakfast. Milly's father was a baker and worked 5 days a week running the town bakery, kneading, rolling and cooking the breads and pastries to perfection. Milly often marvelled at the way he did exactly the same thing every single day and still looked forward to going to work in the morning. In their own kitchen, Mr. Klompet enjoyed creating exotic, if sometimes peculiar, dishes and had once attempted to bake pea pods filled with toffee in order to combine the flavours of savoury and sweet. The result had been disastrous enough to put Milly off both peas and toffee for the rest of her life. But Mr. Klompet was not so easily disheartened. Although some of his experimental cooking was quite horrifying, there were some creations that were quite incredible, like his honey-dipped pear strudel presented in the shape of the Swiss Alps. It was Mr. Klompet's dream to broaden his repertoire and perhaps one day make a passion fruit strudel. But apples and pears were all that were available in Drabville, as the more exotic fruits were prohibited due to the mood-changing properties they contained. Such was Mr. Klompet's inventiveness that in a different world, he would almost certainly have been hosting his own cooking programme on national television. But as neither inventiveness nor television was tolerated in Drabville, Mr. Klompet had to be content working with the limited resources available to him. In the Drabville bakery, like any other commercial enterprise of the town, departure from routine was strictly forbidden. The townsfolk were wary of change, and most customers only ever bought the same type of white sliced bread that tasted like bedsheets. And if you have ever chewed on bedsheets in the middle of the night during a particularly bad dream, then you will know just how horrid they can taste. But the bland taste buds of his customers did not seem to bother Mr. Klompet. He met anyone and everyone with a huge grin plastered all over his flour-smudged face. Of course, the townsfolk regarded him as a Drabvillian no different from themselves. He abided by the town rules, read the code of conduct each night before bed, and never questioned the edicts of the mayor. Therefore, he was an accepted and respected citizen, and poor Mr. Klompet could not have been more devastated to find that his youngest daughter Millie would never be. If you were to ask me to sum up Millipop Klompet's personality in one word, you would be wasting your precious and valuable time, for the simple reason that there is not one word in even the most comprehensive of dictionaries that could come close to describing her. Millie was mad. She was ludicrous and bizarre, yet thoughtful and imaginative. She was spontaneous and passionate, bold and spirited. If I asked you to tell me the first thing that pops into your head when I say the word day, you would most likely reply something along the lines of night, or perhaps if you were very creative, sky. If I were to ask Millie the same question, she would probably reply pomegranate. There is something very curious about a girl who sees links between an exotic red fruit in the daytime, which did not quite fit in with the conventions of Drabville. However, Millie's appearance was the most palpable example of her singularity. With creamy porcelain skin, an impish face and grave brown eyes that widened to orbs at the thought of adventure, Millie had the appearance of a china doll. But, unlike a china doll's sleek and burnished locks, her hair caused her no end of trouble. She simply could not discipline her unruly mop of dark curls, which by midday had always managed to wriggle free of the obligatory chignon she twisted them into every morning. Since her mother had died, Millie had taken on a permanently unkempt look. Her shoes were scuffed, her socks mismatched, and her pinafores not only looked too small, but showed signs of having been hastily ironed. Mr. Klompet was generally too preoccupied to arrange appointments with hairdressers or seamstresses. Millie despised her regulation uniform. The metal buttons of her grey pinafore, which she was required to wear over a pleated wool skirt and stiff collared blouse, gave her a permanent itch at the back of her neck. Whenever the itching became too much to bear, Millie would tear open the top buttons of her pinafore, only to be shouted at by the music master at Drabville Elementary School, Mr. Trevor Treble. Trevor Treble was a bug-eyed, frog-like man in his 60s, who strutted about in his academic gown and took great pleasure in pointing his baton at non-compliant students and bellowing, "Buttons!" Millie had accrued a great number of demerit points as a result of those bothersome buttons, not to mention various other misdemeanors. For one thing, her socks simply refused to stay up, and invariably slid down her legs, crumpling around her ankles like deflated balloons. Her blouse came untucked, her shoes unlaced, and there wasn't a thing she could do about it. Milly was the music master's prime victim, and the state of her hair and uniform had been known to cause him heart palpitations. The other children, whose uniforms never fell short of immaculate, had given up trying to befriend Milly long ago. She warded them off with fierce scowls, dark looks, and sometimes even threats of magic, which alone was enough to keep them well at bay. Magic of any kind, including card tricks, was forbidden in the town of Drabville, and there was nothing the children feared more than the consequences of breaking the rules. They all remembered a terrible day in November some 3 years back, when a small boy of 12 named Leo took the unprecedented step of not returning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.